Thank you, Alexander, and thank you to all organizers for this nice invitation and for giving me the opportunity to present our research at this very nice student conference. Okay, I want to talk about mathematical modeling of the brain. Here you see a cartoon of the brain that shows how information may flow through different areas, but of course this is a highly oversimplified model that will not help us to understand how information is processed in the brain. To understand how the brain really works, we need to zoom in and look at a little piece of cortex, for example, and what we see is this incredible complex network of nerve cells, where in each cubic millimeter we have 10 to 100,000 of neurons. There's a lot of wire, so we have 3 kilometers of dendrite and axons and so on. Nerve cells are highly recurrently connected, so one neuron typically gets on the order of 10,000 connections, so-called synapses from other neurons. So this network is obviously already very complex, but that's not all. Already the single unit in the network is a complex machinery. It's a nonlinear device that transforms the inputs or the spikes from many other neurons into an action potential, or also called a spike. So these spikes are the main information-carrying signals in the brain that are transmitted between neurons. So one important question is, how does macroscopic behavior and dynamics arise from the interactions of all these many neurons? And it is known that networks of neurons can produce various dynamical behavior, for example, oscillations, multistability, fixed point attractor dynamics, line attractor dynamics, etc. And these dynamics on the macroscopic level, they have been implicated in various brain functions, such as working memory or decision making, etc. So it's important to understand the dynamics that emerges in the brain. So here's one example of collective activity that probably emerges in the cortex. These are 16 cells that are simultaneously recorded in the visual cortex, V4 of monkey. And you see this, that neurons, they co-vary, so they go all together into a kind of up state and then down to a down state, and they fire very irregular, but there's also high covariability. And such variability that is an emergent property of the network might be very helpful for us to understand in which dynamical regime cortex is operating. There have been many studies that looked at variability, especially also as a function of a stimulus. So here's one example of a cortical neuron, so the membrane potential of such a cell, that shows large trial-to-trial variability. And upon stimulus onset, this variability, but also the mean, has some dynamics, and also one sees that the trial-to-trial variability shrinks. So these effects are very interesting and could give interesting information about the dynamics. And yeah, it's unknown how these effects emerge as a collective effect. In this talk, I will not answer these questions, but rather I will provide or present a mathematical framework that may be useful for understanding cortical dynamics and variability. And especially, I believe that we need mathematical models on different spatial scales, and we need to be able to link the different scales so as to trace back some dynamic that emerges, trace this back to the microscopic origin. Okay, now I will speak about models at different scales. So there are microscopic models, macroscopic models, and mesoscopic models. I will tell you about this now. So on the one hand, there are microscopic models where in the large network, each neuron is modeled individually. So there are biophysically very detailed models where each cell is modeled by the biophysics, for example, by a Hodgkin-Huxley type neuron. And we could also have somewhat simpler networks of integrated fire point neurons, but there could still be like a microscopic network model. So one famous example is the Blue Brain Project that studies reconstructed neocortical microcircuit in very much biophysical detail. So this patch of cortex that is modeled contains about 30,000 neurons. There are about 200 different cell types that need to be modeled differently. But also, it turns out that in this model, the synapses have also their dynamics. So there's also synaptic dynamics, such as short-term synaptic plasticity, like depression and facilitation. So obviously, this model is so complex and computationally expensive that one needs to run this on a supercomputer or with large computational power. So that's indeed done. And once this such a simulation is performed, one may get out some spatiotemporal spike patterns. So this may be one example, if one is lucky, to see some emerging collective effect. You see here spike trains of many example neurons, and they synchronize here. So you see a wave of synchronization. And the question is, do we really understand with such a model how such collective behavior, like synchronization in this case, emerges? And I think there's no way to understand this from such a microscopic model, because the model is so high dimensional that it's simply too complicated to get some mechanistic understanding of emergent properties. Okay, so one way to deal with this is to go to another scale, to a macroscopic scale, where we summarize the activity of many neurons into one coarse-grained collective variable, and we get so-called population models. So this is a model for a cortical microcircuit that contains different cortical layers, and each layer contains excitatory and inhibitory cells. That's a model proposed by in Jülich, also in the HBP, by Potjans and Diesmann. And here we see populations, and if they are large enough, we may describe them by the population activity. So the population activity is something, is a very simple thing. It's just, if you look at this population, you look at the spike trains, and then we count the total number of spikes in a small time bin and divide this total number of spikes by the time step and by the number of neurons. So it's an estimate of the current firing rate or population rate. It gets the total coarse-grained effect or activity at that time t. So for this population activities, there are heuristic models, so-called firing rate or neural mass models, that are very popular. They are also called sometimes Wilson-Cowen equation or field models. So one instantiation is as follows. One says that the population activity at time t of let's say one population alpha here is a nonlinear function of some input. So this nonlinear function could, for example, be the steady state transfer function of a typical neuron in that population, or the FI curve. Yeah, so one passes this variable h through this nonlinear function, and the variable h integrates up the synaptic input from all other population beta with some synaptic efficacy j. And then there is also some time constant tau that tells us about the typical integration time scale. Okay, so this model is completely heuristic, but it's actually very successful in computational neuroscience because it's so simple. Yeah, it's mathematically tractable. It's only one-dimensional, so it's just maybe the simplest differential equation that you could imagine. It's just a first-order dynamics, and it allows to study many dynamical structures that can emerge, and it's mathematically tractable. However, there are important limitations. One is that it's unclear how the parameters in this model relate to the underlying biophysics or to a microscopic model. For example, this time constant tau is unclear. It's just some time constant. It's unclear how it relates to a microscopic model. And this firing rate model faces a lot of challenges. So one challenge is neuronal refractoriness and spike synchronization. So if one looks at spike train of a neuron, there's a very basic property, namely refractoriness. So spikes cannot become arbitrarily close to each other, but usually it's more difficult for a neuron to fire just after it has fired. And this gives some temporal structure and correlations between spikes. So this also has an effect on the response to stimuli. So now imagine that one inserts such a current into a cell and looks at the population response. So usually at the onset of such a step current, one sees a synchronization of the spikes, so the increased stimulus synchronizes spikes, it leads to a peak, but then because of refractoriness, then there is a trough shortly following, and we get such a ringing, oscillating behavior. So such effect is readily obtained in a population of integrate and fire spiking neurons. As you see here, it's a model of 500 neurons, and the population activity shows such oscillations. That's fine. However, there's no way to get such oscillations with a simple firing rate model because it's simply a first order dynamics. You can only get exponential decays back to the equilibrium. There's no way to get any oscillations. So this is not possible. So this spike synchronization is not possible with a firing rate model. So the second challenge is spike frequency adaptation. It's also a ubiquitous phenomenon across different cell types. That means that in response to a step current, first the firing frequency is high, but then if nothing changes any further, the firing rate goes down. So this effect is also readily obtained in integrated fire models or in generalizations of this that have some adaptation mechanism. So this can be seen here, the population activity of these generalized integrated fire models. They show this ringing because of short-term refractoriness, but then on a long time scale, the frequency is decaying down. So the classical firing rate models do not have this effect. It's unclear how these spike adaptation mechanisms have to be incorporated into a rate model. So the third challenge for firing rate models are finite size fluctuations. So we saw that this, so mathematically the firing rate model is a deterministic model, and this implies that we assume an infinite number of neurons in our population. Of course, this is not possible, so we have a limited number of cells in our brain, but more so, people have counted cell numbers at a given position in cortex and found that the numbers are actually small. So here is one example of a barrel cortex, where red are the number of excitatory neurons in a given cortical layer, and they are on the order of 1,000 cells per layer. And the number of inhibitory neurons is even smaller, they are on the order of 100 neurons only. So this is something that I will call mesoscopic. Or in general, I will call a mesoscopic model everything that is smaller than infinite number of neurons. Okay, so this has important implications for the stochasticity of our model. So this can be illustrated as follows. So it's actually also simple. So imagine that we have stochastic neurons, like a Poisson, inhomogeneous Poisson process. And now we add up, let's say, 100 of these stochastic neurons. So we get a population activity that will strongly fluctuate around its mean, because we sum up only over 100 neurons. But then, so in mathematics called the law of large numbers, if we could average over more neurons, then the noise would shrink, and for very large populations, there would be very small fluctuations. So this effect for small populations to have this still this strong noise that is not averaged out is called finite size noise. And this could be, given these neuron numbers, could be an important source of variability in cortex. Okay, so this is not included in the classical firing rate model, so we cannot describe with this model the oscillations and also not the noise. So this model is too simple. So I want to propose a better model, and for this I want to make a systematic reduction, basically from bottom up. So derive a mesoscopic firing rate model starting from a microscopic network model. And for this, I will not start with any biophysical detailed model, but will directly start with so-called generalized integrate and fire model that can be fitted to experimental data. So the parameters of this model can be extracted directly from single neuron recordings. Okay, so this model works as follows. You imagine here a cell, membrane potential, it's a point neuron model actually, and it has two variables, so this membrane potential U and a second variable theta, which is a threshold, a dynamic threshold. The membrane potential has this form of a passive membrane dynamics that integrates up any currents, external currents, but also synaptic currents, and upon spike time, the membrane potential is reset to some reset potential. That's called leaky integrate and fire model. But on top of this, there's also the dynamics of the threshold that is moving. So at each spike time, such a filter function theta is added. So when there's a spike, we add this theta, and this can accumulate if there are closed spikes and giving rise to adaptation. So furthermore, the question is, how are actually spikes generated in this model? So we don't have a hard threshold here, but we have a stochastic spike generation, and this can be defined by such a Hazard rate that tells us what is the probability to have a spike in the next time step. Yeah, and this probability is given by a function of the difference between membrane potential and threshold, and this function is usually an exponential function. So this seems to be a good fit to neurons. Okay, So this model has refractoriness because just after the spike, the distance between membrane potential and threshold is large, so it's difficult to fire. And there's also adaptation because this can accumulate over longer time scales. So this model can be fitted very efficiently to voltage recording of single cells, and once they're fitted to on some training data, this model predicts quite accurately the spikes in response to novel stimuli. So not only spikes, but also the sub-threshold membrane potential. So as I said, this parameter extraction is very efficient, it's rapid, and there are automated fitting procedures that are used by the Allen Institute nowadays, and parameters for different cortical cell types are cataloged in this Allen Cell Types database. So what's interesting also, what has been found for some cells, like pyramidal cells, that the adaptation, which is contained in the threshold kernel, has very slow components, so which last up to 10 seconds. So it means a spike is still felt 10 seconds later, which is a huge time compared on the neural time scale, which is on a time scale of milliseconds. That's kind of interesting. Okay, so I will use this model because it can be fitted to neurons, but it's also advantages, as it turns out, to derive population equations. Now I will tell you how we can get equations for this model for populations of these GIF neurons. Okay, so we can simulate such a cortical column model consisting of GIF neurons, getting spikes of all neurons, so that's a microscopic model, and then compute the population activities. But I want to have a corresponding population model where one only needs to simulate the population activities, and they are direct results of the simulation, and they should have the same statistics as what we obtain in a microscopic simulation. So this is difficult, and we need some approximations to derive such an effective mesoscopic model. So the first approximation is called mean field approximation, and is as follows. So what on the microscopic level, what we use for the connectivity is a random network with fixed in-degree, such that a neuron in population beta is connected to another neuron in population alpha, this with probability p alpha beta and strength j alpha beta. And in the mean field approximation, so first of all here, each neuron is different, yeah, because each neuron sees a different subset of presynaptic neurons, so actually it's very complex. But statistically, all neurons see, on average, just the same input, and mean field theory replaces the precise input by an average interaction, by the so-called mean field. And in this case, this amounts to replacing the microscopic model by an effective network with full connectivity, so an all-to-all connected graph, but with rescaled synaptic weights, where the weights are p times j now. So this is nice because the synaptic current into any neuron is the same for all neurons. Yeah? So if everybody is connected to everybody, then everybody sees exactly the same thing. So what we get is a synaptic current that drives the neuron. This can be expressed by the population activity, and we have to sum over all population activities. So there are some things here like this. It's a synaptic filtering kernel. It's not important here to understand. So now all neurons see the same current. So the only thing that is now different from the perspective of the membrane potential is the time of the last spike or the time of the last reset. Actually, all neurons that had the same last spike time or the same time of the reset, last reset, have the same membrane potential because they are subject to the same current. So the idea is that we can relabel neurons by their last spike time. However, this is unfortunately not yet doable because we have the second variable, which is the threshold. And this depends on all past spike times, on the full history. Yeah? Now, there's an interesting idea developed by Richard Noh that tells us, okay, if you look at the spike history of a given neuron I, then the last spike before time t is very important for the neuron. This has a strong influence on the current firing probability. But the rest can be taken just on average, what was the population activity, so the mean field. And this leads to an effective threshold that depends on the last spike time and on the history of the population activity. So in effect, we can express our firing rate for neurons with the last spike time t hat and for the common population history just by this function, by this effective membrane potential and threshold. So that's very nice because we can characterize neurons by a single state variable, namely its last spike time, or equivalently the time since its last spike. So this lends itself to population density methods, and it's nice we have only a one-dimensional state space. This works as follows. So the problem is we have already simulated the activity until time t, and the question is, what will be activity in the next time step? So how many neurons will spike? So this can be predicted easily because we only need to know how many neurons had a last spike time of, let's say, 10 milliseconds, how many 20 milliseconds, and so on. In general, we need to know the distribution of the last spike times in the past. And this is given by the activity, so how many neurons had spiked at a certain point in time in the past, times the probability that a neuron has spiked at this time point has not spiked before time t, so that we really get the last spike. And this is called the survival probability, as given by this integral expression. Okay, so now each last spike time has its firing probability, and to get the total activity at time t, we just need to sum up all firing probabilities with respect to all possible last spike times in the population. So this gives rise to this integral or sum over all last spike times from in the full past. And this equation, it's an integral equation, is known for a long time. It's valid for infinitely many neurons, and it can be implemented on a computer, and so you can rapidly integrate your macroscopic activity forward in time. It captures all the refractoriness of the single neurons and adaptation. So I want now to extend this this population equation to a finite number of neurons, and this is usually it's much more difficult. So what is easy is if you have one neuron or if you have infinitely many neurons, but everything that is in between is much more difficult. So we are interested in this finite size effect. However, it's possible, and it turns out that we have again this survival probability defined in the same manner, And then we get at each time point an expected population rate. This is again given by this integral that you saw on the slide before, plus a correction term that accounts for the finite size effect. So that's maybe a lengthy expression, but it's a functional of the past activity. So knowing the past activity, one can compute this on a computer, one can evaluate this and get the expected number of spikes at time t. But this is not the real number of spikes that will happen in the next time step. So what will happen is that one has to draw a Poisson distributed random number with mean n times a bar times dt, and then normalize this in a suitable way. Or if you have many neurons, you can make a Gaussian approximation and say the actual spike count is the mean plus some Gaussian white noise whose variance scales like 1 over n. Okay, so that's a mesoscopic model because it's fully, so it only contains the population, the mesoscopic population activity. There's no single neuron spikes anymore in this model. It can be discretized, so all these integrals can be discretized. You get sums and you can rapidly integrate these equations forward in time. Actually, there is this has also been implemented in the NEST simulator. So it's readily available if you use NEST. And yeah, let's see how this performs, this model. So as a sanity check, we can look at a single population of adapting neurons, no coupling, and we see if we simulate 500 neurons, we see this adaptation. We had this plot before. The integration of this mesoscopic model gives basically the same thing. We can quantify actually whether all these fluctuations have the same properties by looking at the power spectrum of these time series in a steady state. So this is shown here. This is the power spectrum of these fluctuations. So it's power spectrum is the Fourier transform of the autocorrelation function. And we see here the circles, which is the result of a microscopic simulation, and the corresponding power spectrum of the mesoscopic model is displayed in blue. So there's a nice match. So this mesoscopic model has not only the correct mean behavior, but also the fluctuations are correctly described. So the simplest real network would be a network of excitatory and inhibitory neurons. It's very influential. So here is an example of a network that consists of 50 neurons only. So now the finite size fluctuations, they are common to all neurons and they synchronize all neurons, and that's why you see this burst in the population activity. There's two simulations, microscopic model, mesoscopic model, looking at this closer in the power spectrum. For example, if you look at the green curve, you see a perfect match between the symbols and the solid line. Yeah, so the fluctuations are perfectly matched for 50 neurons. And even if you go down to 5 neurons, so it's a mini network of EI network of consisting of 4 excitatory neurons and 1 inhibitory neurons, it still works. Yeah, it's kind of funny. It also works if you have a sparse network, if you have only a connection probability of 20%. Okay, so some non-trivial effect can also be seen if you have a winner-take-all type network. This has been used for explaining perceptual bistability. So maybe you know this Necker cube. When you stare at this for some time, you see the front and the back interchanging, let's say every 10 seconds or so. And this may be due because of finite size fluctuation. So okay, that's a hypothesis. So what we did is to simulate such a network, so 2 excitatory populations that are connected via an inhibitory population. And now this configuration has two attractors, but the system hops between the two attractors because of this finite size noise, so that population one is active at some time, the other is inactive, and then they switch the role, basically, from time to time. So this, so you get this in the microscopic model, but you get the very same thing in the mesoscopic model, but much faster. It has the same statistics, so also the residence time between switchings, they are captured by the mesoscopic model. So and at last example for this finite size networks, we also implemented this for the Potjans and Diesmann cortical microcircuit model. We also added adaptation to this, and then this also works very well. So here's an example of power spectra for the resting state, and we see again a nice match between the blue curves and the symbols, so between mesoscopic and microscopic simulations. Okay, so yeah, so the big advantage here at this level is that we can really rapidly simulate a huge neural network. Yeah, so we get a speed of by factor of 120. Okay, so far we have a mesoscopic model that very accurately reproduces the fluctuations and dynamics of of a microscopic model, but with static synapses. So now we want to, from here there are different paths to go. So one is to show that this framework can be extended to include more and more biophysical features, and the other is to simplify the model. So here I will show for the example of synaptic short-term plasticity that this can also be captured in this model. And for this, we look at the short-term synaptic plasticity that is the following. So the EPSP elicited by a presynaptic spike in a neuron is not constant over, so the amplitude is not constant over time, but it is history dependent. And for depressing synapses, the amplitude will decay if you have a rapid succession of input spikes. And there's also facilitation, which is the converse effect, that actually the EPSP sizes, they grow over time. Okay, so these are dynamic synapses. We model this, so we ask the questions, okay, if you have a presynaptic population containing n neurons, what is how can we approximate the input to a given neuron in the postsynaptic population by a mean field approximation? Okay, so the input can be modeled by this model proposed by Zodex and Markram, where basically the spikes of the presynaptic spike train get an amplitude that is a product of two variables, U and X, and U and X, they are governed also by differential equations, which model somehow the usage of resources in the presynaptic terminal. The question is, can we express this synaptic input with this modulation factor here by the mean field? The population activity, and the population activity can be expressed simply by the sum over all spike trains divided by n. So we worked this out, and the answer is it's possible. So we can represent the input as the population activity multiplied by two stochastic variables that are randomly drawn at each spike of the population activity from a Gaussian distribution with some mean U and X and some covariance matrix. And these variables here, they give rise to five additional equations per population, but five equations is nothing compared to simulating thousands of neurons per population. Yeah? So it's not much. Okay. Let's see whether this works also in a recurrent network. So we can take this theory and put this in our framework. and see that if you stimulate just one population of excitatory neurons and short-term plasticity, one can produce these population spikes. You see this, for example, in a cell culture. Now you see the population spikes for the microscopic model and our mesoscopic model with short-term plasticity, and this is an intermediate model that does not take into account the covariance matrix. It's a naive model. So since the population spikes are driven by the finite size noise in this case, it's important to actually correctly capture this finite size noise. And for 5,000 neurons, the model predicts, or the microscopic model predicts, that there should be almost no population spikes. This is correctly also predicted by our mesoscopic model, but not predicted by this simpler model. And this can be also seen if we plot this as a function of number of neurons, that our second order approximation is actually working well. Power spectra are also well captured by the second order, but not by the by this naive version. Okay, so in the last part, I will talk about actually simplification of our population model to go somewhat toward simpler low-dimensional firing rate models. And for this, we use a method that has been proposed for the Fokker-Planck equation. Namely, we expand our dynamics into the eigenmodes of the, of the system, and only keep the first or dominant eigenmode. And this turns out that this is very simple for the for our integral equation, yeah, because yeah, for this quasi-renewal approximation. So what do we get with this? So at the zeroth order, if you just take the stationary eigenmode, we get the classical firing rate model. Yeah? But now we can get actually the dynamics, for example, the ringing behavior, the oscillations, by taking into account the first eigenmode. And we get this extension, where this model is now three-dimensional, because the variable A1 is a complex valued number. So it has a real and imaginary part, so it's actually two equations here. So we get a three-dimensional dynamics. And this already captures well the ringing behavior in response to step current compared to the exact integral equation. So we can check this also to arbitrary stimuli, for example, periodic stimuli of a given frequency omega. And if this is, if the stimuli is weak enough, the output will also be a cosine function with some phase shift phi and some gain at g, and one can plot this as a function of the frequency. So this is a typical plot. So the integral equation, so the exact result, gives this blue line and shows that there's a resonance at a certain frequency, which is not captured by the classical firing rate model, which is a black line, so the resonance is completely missed. However, with our three-dimensional model, the resonance is nicely captured. Okay, so now we will see what kind of effect can have such single neuron dynamics and yeah, these oscillations. This is an effect of the single neuron dynamics, and I will now show an example where this is important. Yeah. So namely, yeah, okay, one remark, one can also make a mesoscopic version of this. That's quite interesting. So now, as an application, we look at a recurrent networks of firing rate units. So it's known that these networks can produce very rich dynamics. So there's a classical work by Sompulinski and others that looked at a recurrent network where the synaptic weights are Gaussian distributed, and it turns out that that for g smaller 1 there is nothing interesting happening, but if the synaptic strengths are strong enough, there is chaos. So it very irregular dynamics. It's also unstable dynamics, unpredictable. So these are the firing rates of different cells, and this has been could be a reason for the variability that one sees in the brain. Yeah? And it has also been used a lot for as a substrate for reservoir computing. At the edge of chaos, it's usually good to train a neural network to perform certain tasks. Yeah, this has been vastly used in the past. So, however, usually the dynamics of the single units are just taken as a classical firing rate model with a first order kinetics. Now, we were interested, what is the effect of single neuron dynamics? So to this end, we extended this model a little bit by adding an adaptation variable here that obeys, that has a negative feedback, that introduces a negative feedback. So it's now two-dimensional. In general, we can have actually a multi-dimensional rate model. But for this two-dimensional rate model, it turns out that if you plot in the parameter space, the phase diagram, there are two regions. And this is the interesting region here. So this means this is for slow adaptation or strong adaptation. Yeah? You get a resonance in your gain function. Yeah? So not simply a low pass behavior that you get for vanishing adaptation or small adaptation, yeah? as in the classical case. So this has now a strong effect if you couple these rate units into a recurrent network. This is shown here. So here in the dashed line, you see this the resonance of a single neuron. It's actually only a mild resonance. It's not very strong. But now the effect, the emerging effect in the network is that this resonance is strongly sharpened. Yeah, so there's a logarithmic scale here. So you get a strong oscillatory peak in your power spectrum. Yeah, so that you may, one may see here that basically it's still chaotic, but there are pronounced oscillations. Yeah, that could maybe be gamma oscillations or so. And yeah, so the single neuron, the message is the single neuron dynamics strongly affects the emerging network fluctuations. Yeah, and this can also be understood by dynamic mean field theory. I won't talk about this. And this shaping of the network noise, so it's not really noise, it's chaos. Yeah, this also influences signal transmission. Yeah. All right, so with this, I'll come to my summary. So I hope I convinced you to that it is useful to understand emergent cortical activity, to link mesoscopic model to microscopic models. Then I argue that the framework of generalized integrate and fire models is very powerful because, first of all, it can be that these neurons can be efficiently fitted to real cells, and they predict spike times very well. Then they permit to derive very accurate and efficient mesoscopic population models, and it's also possible to reduce this further to low-dimensional firing rate model of the classical firing rate type. So this framework is also extensible to include, for example, short-term plasticity. And one message is that, not only the network connectivity is important to understand the dynamics, but also the single neuron dynamics matters. Yeah? So sometimes this is neglected, but we see that actually single neuron dynamics can be amplified in a recurrent network. Okay, so you can read, if you want, about all these ideas in this recent review article, and there's also some resources here. And finally, I would like to thank the people that were involved, so Professor Gerstner from the EPFL in Switzerland, postdoc Moritz Deger, Then Valentin worked on the short-term plasticity, Samuelo on this on the chaos and recurrent networks, Bastian is postdoc, my group, and Noah also worked on the eigenfunction reduction. Yeah, and with this, I would like to stop and thank you for your attention.